Excellent. So welcome everybody, and thanks for coming along. The seminar that we are about to conduct with our visiting professorial fellow Pat Anderson is going to focus on Aboriginal health research, and it's something that Pat and I look forward to do. I should, before we commence and before I hand over to Pat, acknowledge country and that we're here in the Ngunnawal country, pay my respects to the elders past and present, to any Indigenous people with us today, and of course to Indigenous youth who we know will be the leaders of tomorrow. Pat has a fabulous history, as many of you know. She is now recognised by the Order of Australia as of last week. And yes, and well earned through many years of doing wonderful work, both in education and in health. Okay, Pat, thank you very much. This is your last formal presentation at the University of Canberra. It's been a wonderful having you here.
Thanks, Joan. On behalf of us all, I'd like to acknowledge also Joan's welcome to country and the ancestors, both past, present and in the future. I'm also here today, I'm also the chair of the Lowitja Institute, and I've been involved with the Institute over its four or five iterations. We were funded under the old CRC. We started in the early 1990s, and I was on the original board and one of the founding. I was then CEO of the Dan Ladilba Health Service in Darwin. So I've had a long, actually before it even started, sort of 20-year association with what is now the Lowitja Institute. Historically, for a whole host of reasons, Aboriginal people think that Australia, that research is a dirty word, and it has been, and there's long history for that, and it's through our experience of researchers in the past. So for the Aboriginal Community Control Health Services, like Dan Ladilba and Central Australian Aboriginal Congress in Alice Springs, our decision to be part of the original CRC application was, at the time, and I'm talking now 17, 18 years ago, really was a leap of faith. And we copped a little bit of criticism for doing that, sort of jumping into bed, which was seen by other colleagues and friends as way too quickly. But it has made a difference, and I'm going to talk about that difference today. But also the start of it had a bit of a, and we haven't written down our history, but Professor John Matthews, who was then head of the Menzies School of Health and Research in Darwin, started putting in an application for the CRC, and I happened to come across it, and I thought, what's he doing now? So we had lots of quarrels. We spent about 4 years arguing before he eventually came and knocked on my door one day when I was at Dan Ladilba Health Service. The receptionist said, Professor Matthews is here, Pat, to see you. And I said, well, I haven't got him. She said, no, he's on the way up. He's on up the stairs now. So by the time I put the phone down, he was right at my door there with Marcia Langton.
Uh-oh.
Exactly. I'll get to that in a minute. And he sort of came in and he said, I want to try one more time. And I was really a bit irritated with him. So he and Marcia sat down and I said, she said, talk to me, Pat, you need to listen. This is a, you know, it's something that, it's the future. You need to just give him a space to speak. And I said, I've been talking to John for 4 years about this. And anyhow, I thought, now, how can I really put him off? I said, okay, the only way we'll even consider this is that if you have an Aboriginal chair and if the majority of the members of the board are Aboriginal people. He looked at Marcia and said, oh, I said, we can do that. Talk about snap. But I thought that was so outrageous that he wouldn't go for that, but he did, to his credit. And now, of course, you know, all this time down the track, he's, I suppose, a much revered and respected elder of this whole movement, and has been a movement. So I'm going to talk about that, but in the first place, I just want to show you a slide of our patron. Lowitja was in fact the first chairperson of the very first CRC. It was the CRC for Aboriginal and Tropical Health, because Menzies in those days wanted to do work in Timor on malaria and other places. So that was one of the compromises that we made, but was changed at the next iteration. But that was the very first name of the Institute. And we needed, at the time, the thinking was, this was so new and very ambitious, we needed a chair, someone that had status and standing and could sort of pull people along. And so we approached Lowitja, really had no indication whether she would be interested or not, but she was certainly the right person, in our view, to head up this new body. So to our pleasure, she agreed. She'd just come through those very bitter days of ATSIC and its demise and all the sort of whirly wind that was going around ATSIC at that time. But that was had just finished, and she agreed to be our chairperson of the first CRC, and also now the patron of what's the legacy organisation, which is the Lowitja Institute. So we're very pleased to have her, and she's very interested in what we do. So the board then to this day still has an Aboriginal chair, and an Aboriginal patron, an Aboriginal chair, and the majority of the board are Aboriginal people. I'll just show you a little slide now about how it actually all works together. It's an animated version of how the different groups of people come together, because that's another feature of Lowitja.
Australia has been long considered a strong and healthy nation. However, the journey of our good health and strength began long before the first hospital was built, long before the first medical doctor. The first Australians lived and prospered on this continent for tens of thousands of years. At the core of their culture was a sophisticated system of health, medicine, physical and emotional well-being practices that saw their nations thrive and continue to be one of the oldest living cultures on the planet. However, this incredible journey of health and knowledge over thousands of years is not the story of Australia's first peoples today. Colonisation changed that dramatically. The modern-day story of this strong nation is one of great inequity for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. Colonisation did not just mean the removal of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples from their land and children from their families. It disempowered and disconnected people from their cultural knowledge and traditional practices of health and healing. Traditional practices that had seen them thrive for over 60,000 years. The initial and continuing impact of colonisation on the health and well-being of Australia's first peoples was catastrophic and has flowed on to every generation since. This impact today is measured as the gap. The gap includes many things. The gap exists despite Australia having one of the best healthcare systems in the world. We stand the best chance of closing the gap if we work together to make good decisions to improve health and well-being. Good outcomes grow from good decisions based on good research. The Lowitja Institute is the only health research institute in Australia that has a sole focus on Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander health. We know that we get better outcomes when Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have a strong and leading voice in the research, a seat at the table. Our research model brings together people who hold knowledge about the issues from the beginning of the process. Our research model puts Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people's knowledge and cultural understanding at the heart of the research process and outcomes. The Lowitja Institute works in partnership with communities, researchers, and policymakers across Australia to help facilitate research, so that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people set the agenda and own the outcomes. A nation is only as strong as the health of its people. We all have a role to play in closing the gap.
That to show to all kinds of forums, and what we're stressing there that the Lowitja Institute is made up of Aboriginal community organisations, a whole range of universities, the state government and the Commonwealth government. So it's a sort of a three-way partnership. We talk in terms of partnership because it's also a collaborative approach, because we don't want to be competing for research dollars with our partners and friends and people who have been supporting us over all this time. So that's why we work together, and we're more likely to form a consortium of different agencies to come together, you know, an Aboriginal organisation, a university or two or three, and researcher coming from those institutions. So partnership is really important. At the moment, we're in another phase of the organisations, and we're seeking to get more and more state governments involved. At the moment, we started off with the NT government. We've had a whole range of discussions recently with all of the state governments, and they are all expressing interest to be part of it. So that's really important, to have the policy makers and the decision makers at the table, as well as involving the Aboriginal community in its various forms and combinations, as well as researchers. So that's kind of how we do. So what we do is, Joan, the next slide. All of those. This is what we try to do, so that Aboriginal people are at the core and part of the decision making, not only just the decision making, but making the decision, but actually at the table for the actual design and posing the research question. As you know, you've got to get the question right to sort of get it all sorted out. So Aboriginal people are involved in all of the stages from day one, from the decision being made at the board, because we set the agenda. Traditionally, you know, research has been done by researcher gets a good idea and then looks for a grant, goes to NH&MRC or ARC or wherever, and tries to sort of fund that research. We don't do it like that. We actually set the research agenda by engaging with a whole lot of partners, and a whole lot of other agencies as well. So that's, I suppose, that's it, what we try to do, and I think we're doing okay there. When Lowitja agreed to be the patron, we had this launching of Lowitja at Parliament House, and it was a sort of, you know, pretty grand, modest sort of do. But she was very clear, and we have it sort of framed in our front office. She said, pretty much, now that I've agreed to give my name to this, these are the things that I want you all to do. So she gave us like a set of values, which we all kind of, and we're very mindful of those. So we actually framed them, sent them out to anybody and everybody, so as we're all kind of on track, that we don't, and it's personally, it's quite a challenge as well, because we look like we weren't going to get any money until, you know, the 30th of June this year. Our current CRC funding was running out, and although despite, you know, 3 years of work, there didn't seem to be anything on the horizon. So not only was it going to mean the end of the Lowitja Institute, but then we all then had to go and explain to our patron what we did and didn't do. So it wasn't a professional thing, it was more of a personal thing. That's quite a burden to carry that responsibility on your shoulders. And all the Aboriginal people who do sit on the board are very aware of that, her expectations that we will always do the right thing according to her values. So that's another guiding principle of ours. But one of the things that we have developed, and which I say we change the face of research is this facilitated development approach. Now, this is the way that we actually do our work. Our approach is to sort of, as I've said, not to do it the traditional way, but to sort of come from the community up. We have a whole series of round table discussions on a particular project. And research comes to us from all kinds of ways. We have every 2 years what's called Congress, Lowitja. And we had a meeting in Adelaide a few years ago now. And three women came from Queensland, from the south coast there, and they'd read about the forum. They got themselves there, and arrived and stood up at the meeting and said where they were from, who they were, and we want Lowitja to find out why we are all dying of cancer. Lots of women are getting younger and younger in our community, and we want to know what's happening. So it took us quite a while, it took us 3 years, and we'll see Gail Garvey talking about this in a minute, but what we did a research proposal to NHMRC, quite a large one, and it was $3 or $5 million to look at cancer research in the first place, to just look at what's been written and what's been said, to see if there, and then look what's happening in the Aboriginal community, in that community in particular, if there were any common denominators and if there was any gaps in the research. So that's still going on, and that's actually a network of people. Cancer Council of Australia, Lowitja, whole about QIMR in Queensland. So there's about five or six of us involved in what's now called NICAN, which is a network. So that rather large research project arose out of those three women coming personally to make a plea. And just recently, because we decided not to go into that area, genomics and what have you, and we've had people from the Northern Territory, because that's where we started, and that's where I'm from, come to us and say, we want to know what's happening. There's this disease called McCarter-Joseph disease, and it's only in Alcohol, and it's now on the top of the Northern Territory, and also it's now in the centre. The only other places in the world it happens, I think, is Japan and Portugal. And it's you just die. Everything, all your organs and everything close down. Now, some families on Elko Island get it and some don't. So it's like these two, then this misses this family, and then the next three or four, then it misses two families. So our community, if you like, is asking us to move into that area. So we have to have a whole lot of discussion about that. So that's a very tricky area. Because we've been sort of decades fighting the human genome project, and we've heard all sorts of, we used to call it the vampire project, and bloods and tissues being stored in all kinds of, so we're all absolutely paranoid about it. But now the communities are coming to us and saying, we need for you to find out what the hell's going on here, if you can. So that's been our latest development. But
are you aware that there's a new centre has been set up?
Yes.
Well,
yes, no, we're in touch with them as well. Yes, that's the first thing we did.
Yeah.
Yes, in Melbourne. Them. Yes, we have.
It would be ideal from,
yes,
from that genomics perspective.
Yes, yes, we're talking to them as well. So that was the first call we made, in fact. So we're sort of working through a whole, where the gaps are and what we can do in a sort of small way, or be part of a larger and facilitate, convene a larger combination of different agencies and different people. There has been some research. Menzies did some about 20 years ago, but there hasn't been a lot since. So that's our facilitated development approach. And we've written, and Gail Garvey's going to talk a little bit about that, which I might put on now.
Let's do that now.
Yeah.
But
we'll come back to this.
Oh, I'm going the wrong way, but we're going to go this
where
we've
got the line here, then.
And through from coastline. Okay.
Thank you. talking about Indigenous research. If you don't have Indigenous community members engaged and involved from the very grassroots level, it's more than likely that the research won't work or the intervention won't work. So you need to engage community. That's of high importance. The roundtables are an excellent opportunity to bring all of those groups together and have a discussion about how the research could be conducted, what the found that works or doesn't work. It's valuable information for researchers who are trying to solve, you know, a particular problem, and they can't do that unless they have the know-how which comes from the community.
Well, I guess it's an opportunity for the health practitioners working at the coalface to provide some input into where health research is being directed, what issues are in the community, and how. I guess I see my role here today as a link from the community to the health researchers.
Well, we know that nationally research in the past hasn't been done for often the best outcomes for Aboriginal people themselves. Often they've been there to serve the purposes of the researcher, to further progress their academic career, and I think this process puts that back into Aboriginal hands.
Yes, it hasn't been a lot of input from Aboriginal people, and this goes back quite a way since research has been started, and to me it seems that a lot of the research which is done on Aboriginal people is just put on the shelf and that's it, never used again.
It is good to have people here, Aboriginal people here, at the forefront to go back and then give that information out in the community, because other people have these meetings in the past and where we might not have really been key players. We were told about things later on. So I think this is really important because this will help determine how successful the programs will be, really.
The process this morning has been very good in that I feel that we've been listened to, we've been heard. It's going to be taken away and the actual proposal for chronic conditions management is going to be revamped to the way that we discussed it here today in our research meeting. And we're going to see that it's going to be a lot more stronger.
I guess that we know that this, that we'll all know that the two research proposals that were discussed today at the end of the day are going to be better in quality, but I know that they've gone through a rigorous process of determining, you know, parts of their research and so forth. So for me, it gives me greater confidence in what the researchers are doing at the end of the day.
I think it's a valuable process in that you can collaborate with all of the key stakeholders, that being community workers, community elders, Aboriginal health services, government health services, environmental health workers, people who are just strictly involved in research, I guess, and other interested people all coming around the table in the one session to discuss ideas and importance, and you're really getting a community perspective, engaging in and out with what researchers have found and where they're heading, as well as what's happening at the scientific sort of level.
For me, when I go back, even as a counsellor, I can say that we have had input. Often worries people in the community that research is done without their knowledge, with no input whatsoever. So this, for me, is vital for the council, for the whole community.
If there hadn't been Aboriginal people involved in it, then I think the proposal and the research will actually not achieve a great deal, because there would be no ownership and there would be a loss of having people at the forefront to actually work with the researchers to make it happen.
I didn't know, to be honest, much about the CRC until probably 2 years ago, and I didn't know where they were actually heading, but I think with these sort of workshops and quality assurance processes, I think it's fantastic and invaluable. Not just for Aboriginal people, but non-Indigenous people as well.
That's what the CRC is doing, is the cutting edge of determining how we can better develop research that benefits community at the end of the day. So that for me is all new information, and it's something for me to keep thinking about after today. And certainly I'll be going back to my organisation with the lessons learned out of here.
But I think this process is really valuable, and I think it's unusual for these sorts of discussions to occur. Just yesterday I was in Queensland having discussions with a statewide service about research and trying to work out research agendas. I told them I was coming to Darwin to this round table. They thought it was a fantastic idea, and they're going to try and mirror what's happening here in the round table to their approach to identifying key priority areas in research. So instead of individual community groups, scientists, researchers, organisations doing their own thing, it's an opportunity to bring everyone together, collaborate and have a strategic approach about an issue.
I think that all research bodies should just give their money to the CRC and let them allocate the research.
We did promise.
Because the process that has been developed by the CRC I think is excellent and needs to be replicated across all the research bodies. So why replicate when they can simply give the money over to the CRC to support organisations like the NHMRC to decide on their priorities and things like that. So that's what I would be suggesting.
The other aspects of this
the other aspect
of the facilitated development, as well as having these open discussions, which are very popular. And we started doing what we call roundtables in the first place so we could discuss sensitive issues and what have you. But they're now growing. They're the main focus for people having those sorts of discussions to decide and get clear in their minds what sort of research they want to do. The other thing important about the facilitated development approach is that from day one we were very big on knowledge exchange, that the research had to be written in such a way that it could be easily translated and returned to the community, or that community meaning might be, you know, the people who are suffering from chronic diseases. So community is a bit of a difficult word sometimes. So it's all the different people that might be affected by that research, so it can be easily understood, and that agencies, state health departments, but also AMSs, you know, really remote ones, what's the latest thinking on, say, smoking or alcoholism or what have you. So they can access this information easily, and it's readable. And we try often in those areas that it can be easily, from plain English, easily translated into other languages. So the research is actually, it's relevant, but also it's then used. Often the most difficult people, of course, with all researchers, you know, still have the hoary question of trying to influence politicians and policy makers of the day. That still exists. Although some of the work that we've done, for instance, the overburden report that traced the accountability process that all the AMSs had, and it was a huge project. In the end, they sort of just drew a sort of map, and it looks like people had stood back and thrown a bowl of spaghetti on all the sort of intersecting lines where people had to, and that's been very powerful and very useful. Even if they hadn't, if the policy maker or the department hadn't read the research, just by, you know, looking at the diagram. And that did change, the office, the OATSI did change as a result of that research. So it's not, they're not all, you can affect change. So that knowledge exchange is really important, and that's actually written in. In the very early days, it was part of the research proposal, and we fell out with quite a few researchers because for the first time we're putting responsibility on them to actually disseminate the research or to ask them how they were going to do this. Now, in those days, they weren't used to doing this, and they were really offended that we would ask them that, but that's been a strong path in also this facilitated development approach. The other one is capacity building. When we started the CRC in the early 90s, I think there were like two Aboriginal researchers in the country, and they were just starting to hit their straps as well, though I hadn't quite. It was Ian Anderson and Marcia Langton. There wasn't anybody else. And now there's a whole cohort. Several of those young women there, Gail Garvey, the first speaker, she's now is the head researcher for the NICAN cancer. We helped her sit down, we did the round table, and then we sat down with Gail and wrote up the rather complicated proposal to go to NHMRC. And so we've just done an advertisement again, was in the press in the last on the weekend, fellowships, so we give full up PhD scholarships, we do fellowships, and we also do, people want to do just complete a Cert 4, or maybe a master's student that needs a laptop. So we do the whole range, and we have an intake every year, and there's a process, and we advertise, and people apply. So as a result of, you know, like almost 17 years there, we have some fine Aboriginal researchers around the country who are out there actually practicing their craft and haven't become public servants yet. They haven't been snaffled. They're actually, you know, quite comfortable and confident and enjoy the work that they do. Those are the two things, that roundtable discussion involving Aboriginal people from the word go, and the knowledge exchange and the capacity building. Now, for non-Aboriginal researchers, most of our researchers are non-Aboriginal because they come from the universities and what have you, and QIMR has been a fantastic supporter of Lowitja from day one. They're actually on our board, in fact, at the moment. They have been on our board from the beginning. But what was I saying? I forgot now.
Non-Aboriginal
people, yes. Having gone through this process that's just been described so eloquently in about the facilitated development proposal, that non-Indigenous researcher knows that they have the approval. So when they go and work with the community, all of that, all the courtesies and responsibilities and everything's really clear. So then they are freed up to actually get on with the work. So they don't have to worry with community relationships so much. It's all a sort of a clear path for them. So they can do what they do best, and that's do research. So that makes it very attractive for researchers to come and work and be part of the Lowitja Institute. We don't have rooms of researchers. We talk to our partners. We make up the best combination for whatever the topic is and look for the best in their field, in that area. And that's how it's done. So we sort of go to our partners and others as well on how we do it. Now, the sort of development approach, we've got these three articles there that have captured what it is, and these articles are available, Joan. So I don't think I'll go through them. But one is called Putting Users of Research in the Driver's Seat. So they're sort of seminal documents, if you like, for Lowitja, and they're all on our website. So this Indigenous research reform agenda started some time ago, 1997, 2003. It was carried out with a significant body of work at the time, and it helped to consolidate a long history of reforms to improve Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people's health. So that's captured in that the first slide there, Jane, the Indigenous Research Reform Agenda. And there'll be a slide at the end which will show you where you can find all of these articles. So I spent quite a lot of time really sort of talking about it, but actually articulating what it is that we do and why it's different. And to operationalise that comes in the second part there, putting the user. That in fact it operationalises the sort of development approach. And then there's the third one. That's a quite a large piece of work as well. So that further expands and develops what we do, that sort of development approach. Now the last slide, John, is these two books have been really, really helpful, and Lowitja is happy to supply a box of books there for people as a self-explanatory. This one, the supervisory report, has been very well received. It's for people who are supervising Aboriginal students. We've had it out for a while, and I was a bit guilty that I hadn't talked about it before. So I'm arranging for a box to come in. I just talked to Joan about who to send it to, so you can have a look and send a box of each, so you can disseminate them and just have a look. So I'm happy to answer questions, but and Joan, I think the next slide, that our site's really easy to find. So all of this literature, plus all of our research that we've done, will all be on the webpage, I think with a synopsis as well, so it's an overview. So you can find the research, press the button and get it free off the web. Of course it's free. So Lowitja is definitely now on the scene in terms of the part of the research landscape. We do have, our budget still isn't secure. We got 5 years funding from the previous government. So we see that as 5 years, gives us 5 years to find the sustainable budget. And we already started that work about 4 years ago, and we have a submission into the, we had a submission in, but now we're going to go back and give it to the next lot. But we did quite a lot of talking within Parliament House, both those who are in government and those who weren't in government and now are in government. We have to go back and talk them through that again. We did a review for the McKeon review for the NH and MRC, and part of our ideas were taken up in that review. And so that's what we're promoting, the Canadian model for Australia, because they have a similar institute to Lowitja and have had for quite a few generations now. So that's a sort of, and it did get some traction there in Parliament House. People thought that it had some merit. And we have started just about to begin discussions with Fiona Nash. So that's where we're at the moment. We've got 5 years, but hopefully we'll have a sustainable budget so we can really establish ourselves in the landscape. The funding that we have now from the it's CRC, we didn't apply for a CRC application because we couldn't. You know, three times you can't go again. But because of all the lobbying we'd done, and we did have some support, I think, in the department and in Parliament House, and I think the discussion that, yes, we want to fund this lot, but how do we do it? And what they did was look at the CRC budget and said, there it is. So they phoned up the CRC lot and said, give Lowitja $25 million out of here. And there's no process for that. So we spent a bit of time with the CRC trying to work out a process, and we have now. But we didn't want CRC money, and we said to them, because it's too many things that you have to do, and we said, look, we're not going to do all of that, but we're happy to do this. We'll do this for you. I said, oh yes, there's a bit of to-ing and fro-ing, but they didn't have a precedent for this. They just had to scramble around and find one, and they did. And they work with us, and so now we've just all signed off. So that's really good, because we've got CRC money, the old CRC, till the end of June this year, and then the five-year funding will cut in then. But they didn't have an application for us. They didn't know. In fact, it was several days before someone got around to telling them that you've got to give this mob this $25 million that's sitting here. So it was a good outcome for us. A bit of scurrying around, but it was good.
So how much philanthropic funding?
Yes, we have a lot of contact so far with that world. Currently, the CEO that we've had for the last 2 years, Lynn Brody, comes from that area. So she's been introducing us. That is an area that we know nothing about. So we had to get somebody in who would lead us and guide us and direct us. And Lynn has done that with all the networking that she has. Everyone's very supportive, but no one's opened their checkbook yet. But there are lots of smaller funds that are quite interested in what we do and have indicated to us that they would be quite happy to part fund. They like the idea of putting together a combination of people, an Aboriginal organisation or two, a university, and one or two of their organisations. So that's okay. So there's some movement there. But getting the endowment, like QIMR have had in the past, that's not on the horizon yet. But we're getting lots of support in the area, and it's been very good. But like I say, nobody's opened their checkbook yet. But the entree might be this cobbling together, a combination of people, including the smaller funds.
So mining organisations are coming in.
Sorry?
Mining organisations are.
Now we haven't been there. We have to have. We had this discussion very early.
Want to or
you
don't want to?
Well, we have to have the discussion again. We had this discussion earlier in the piece and decided that we probably wouldn't. And we had an internal process to sort of reject. And so far, we haven't gone to the mining companies. But we have to have that discussion again at the board about why we wouldn't. Of course, we don't go to cigarettes or alcohol, of course. That's what you understood. We didn't even have to have a discussion about that. But there is another discussion to be had about mining companies. But so far we haven't been there.
Do you see a difference between Indigenous research and Indigenous research?
That's a very hoary question. It's a bit like asking me, what is culture? I'm not going to go anywhere near that. That's just too difficult. I think one of the young people on the YouTube there, and I think it does make a difference when you have Aboriginal people involved in the research and working side by side with a non-Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander researcher. I think it gets to a depth that normally it wouldn't do, because we're still a bit suspicious of researchers, so we'll tell this bit of the story. We might not necessarily go here, but with an Aboriginal person who's clearly seen working in partnership with a non-Aboriginal researcher, I think you're likely to get this. So I think the depth and breadth of the question that's being put, I think an Aboriginal person can add texture to that research. So I think that's the difference when you involve now. Whether there's Indigenous research, I don't want to go there, Kerry. I think it's more adding to the texture of what's already happening. Because, Australia is, really well thought of in the research world. And I hate to use this expression, but we do because of our size and numbers. But we do punch way above our weight. The leading medical research is most of it's done in Australia. We've done so much work. So we've got a good reputation nationally and, more importantly, internationally in certain fields. So I think having an Aboriginal person involved in it and actually doing the research, you get that extra value, that extra texture and depth and width to it, is my view.
About the National Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Health Plan.
Yes.
The current government has,
yes,
I suppose, accepted or taken that up.
Yes.
What would Lowitja like to see in the implementation?
We're going to be involved in that process because there's a body which we set up, and we don't have an office or anything. It's called the National Aboriginal Health Forum, and it's all the Aboriginal peak bodies that work in the health space. We all come together from time to time, and we work with the Commonwealth Government through its department, OADC then, it's now changed, to come up with the National Health Plan. And it was quite a lot of work and a lot of argy-bargy, and it was quite difficult. But for the first time ever, we were able to convince the government to agree to have a cultural aspect to it, and also to talk about racism. And those two subjects are sort of, they wouldn't go near. So that's been accepted, and that's in the plan now. Fiona Nash has read that plan, and she's very keen. And she's been to the Prime Minister and they've decided to accept it. They will make some changes, and that's okay, because we weren't ourselves 100% happy with some of the changes that the department wanted to make. So there's a bit of an opportunity there. But what the tricky bit is what she says, is they're now going to come up with an implementation plan to operationalise it. So we'll see. We've been monumentally unsuccessful, actually, doing that. But it's also it's got to be across government, which is a bit of a mythology. It rolls off the tongue very nicely, but it's very, very difficult to make that happen. But there is a bit of an opportunity here, and we don't know how this lot are going to respond, but they have accepted the plan, and they've agreed to work with us, and they've agreed to do an implementation plan. But no one's talking dollars yet either. So we're a long way, I reckon, Sam, from making that actually happen. I mean, anything, it's too fraught. But we'll see.
Sounds like you do better than the National Food Plan. Pushed off the agenda.
Well, they've taken billions of dollars out of the health sector, but also to the impact, not only the co-payment, but the impact of the changes to the Centrelink payments and what have you. You know, people under 30 and, I mean, in the Pitt lands, for instance, the APY lands, they have something like 60% of the population is under 30. So, and now they've got to go into all these places and get a letter if they've been to all these job, you know, for interviews for jobs. I mean, I think that's a bit hard when you're 600k south of Alice Springs. So I don't know, I really, it's going to cause tremendous hardship. There's a whole lot of people looking at all of the input. I'm part of that group with the NHLF plus a whole lot, a few other people. Not only Aboriginal organisations, because all of these things affect everybody. So we've been really clear that we're not just talking, we're involved, but it's also, you know, the ACOS and ANTAR and Oxfam and a whole lot of agencies that also work in that space. We've come together to sort of mount and provide information. That's where Lowitja comes in, because we can provide some of the impact on some of this and the changes to Medicare. Stephen Duckett's done work for us in the past. So there's, we do have access to people who are respected thinkers in those fields. We haven't got that far yet, but certainly there is a campaign being mounted as we speak against some of the changes that are going to affect marginalised people and, you know, single income families, people with disabilities as well. So there's a bit of work to do. So we're part of the Lowitja Institute, is part of those, but we see our role as providing the evidence to back up what we're actually saying, rather than be kind of, you know, the front of manning the barricade, so to speak. We'll provide some of the evidence. So that's, I think that's clearly, that's legitimately a role for Lowitja Institute.
Pam, can you just explain the distinction between IATSIS and Lowitja? I mean, IATSIS has a broader role than health, clearly, but there are other ways in which what they do and what Lowitja do.
They
does
don't. They don't work in any way like Lowitja does at all. Look, we're very proud of IATSIS. It's our keeping place, and we want that to continue. But we're not in competition. IATSIS sits on our board and has done from the beginning. So we see them as partners. They're in fact owners of Lowitja, along with other Aboriginal organisations. So I don't think there's any conflict there, and they don't do this facilitated development approach, and they don't do that wide scope either. So it's a completely different way of operating.
And it serves a different need, doesn't it?
Different needs, different client group.
Government too.
Yeah. And it's a government agency. Yeah. See, Lowitja is an Aboriginal community control research organisation. It's, you know, come a long way in that research world to be able to stand today and say that. 10 years ago, you'd think everyone thought we were just crazy to even think about it. But we started this journey. Well, I've been on this journey for 20 years now, and a lot of other people. And like I say, the first 4 years I spent the time arguing with, bless him, with Professor Matthews. So there we are. So two different organisations, Joan, but they're partners.
Pat, my name's Tess Ryan. I'm a Biripi woman, and I've just started a PhD. I'm doing comparative analysis of leadership models for Indigenous women in Australia. And what I'm sort of noticing is there seems to be an awful lot of female researchers going into areas of health. There seems to be a lack of men going into these areas. Do you know why that is? And do you think, how do you think we can encourage more Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people to take on sort of the research role?
Well, We do have some men, of course, and sort of prominent. I mean, I think one of our sort of lights, shining lights, is
Ian Anderson.
No, younger than Ian.
Oh,
from
Magdalene,
but also
Ray Lovett.
Ray Lovett.
Yeah.
Sorry, Ray Lovett. You know, Ray Lovett. There's a group of people of that calibre and quality that are functioning, you know, out there, like I say, practicing their craft. So there's a small group, but quite a, I think, getting ever more distinguished group of younger men. Ian's, yeah, he's of the first wave. It's interesting, we've got a couple of waves of people operating in the same space. If you were talking to someone the other day at lunch about this, like if you drew a series of circles, there's a whole lot of people all overlapping. You know, there's people like me who are on the stage and sort of going off slowly, but nevertheless, you know, exiting. And then there's a sort of a middle group, you know, of young people, you know, like you guys that are there operating and sort of getting experience. And then there's the new ones, you know, the 22, 23-year-old that are coming onto the stage. So there's sort of three groups of people. But getting Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander men involved has always been an issue. And we've been saying for decades now that there needs to be more Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander men health workers. Mm-hmm. But I think we have quite a few male doctors across the professions. We were very aggressive in seeking people out to apply for various scholarships and what have you. But there's no silver bullet for this, like with across the board, with everything. Maybe when people like me finally exit, there will be a whole pile of younger men. They're there on Lowitja board, for instance. We have a fantastic group. In fact, there's only two women on the board now. There's seven of us, they're all young men. Fantastic. At the height of their careers, so it's really great. So it provides new energy too, different kind of energy as well to Lowitja, or they will do because some of them are just new. But they're very experienced, and like I said, they'll take us to this new direction. We also have just appointed an Aboriginal man to the CEO, Romney Mokek. So he too will provide different energy, backed up by a very young male, most predominantly male board. So when more and more things like that happen, yeah. I'm just so pleased to see all these young, especially young men,
yeah.
That are putting their hand up. It's really good. I feel like, well, maybe we're getting somewhere.
That might be a good place to finish and just thank Pat again.
Oh, no. My pleasure.
All that you've done.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming.
Okay.